To this week's version of our International Invest Problems Seminar. So we're happy today to have Otmar Sjöris talking about projection and diffraction tomography of particles in a trap. Thanks a lot for joining us and giving a talk, Otmar.
Okay, thanks Knut, thanks Katja for the nice invitation. It's really a pleasure to give a talk in Irvine. I would like to come to California once again, but let's see if we can manage to do this. So what I will talk about today is some work which several people have been involved. There are also experimentalists, in particular Monika Ritsch-Marte, who is a physicist from the University of Innsbruck. The rest is more or less mathematicians and computational scientists. So what this work is about is a microscopy technique which is somehow visualized in the left image. So the idea is to somehow move a particle which you see, for instance, in the middle image, and then to rotate it with tweezers, with optical or acoustical tweezers. So it's not like in standard microscopy where the probe is pressed on a glass plate and fixated and put in an unhealthy environment. It's just in a more vivid environment, and it's rotated by these tweezers to make a 3D volumetric image. So the right image then shows some projection images. This is what you actually record at the end. Okay, so this is here a typical movie of a pollen grain which is recorded when the particle is moved. With these tweezers, and this is some images of my colleagues from Monika Ritsch-Marte, which I mentioned already before. And you see here that these are projection images. So somehow you shine light on this pollen grain, and then you just visualize the shading, so the projection images. And what you also can observe is that from these images already that the movement of this pollen grain is not very regular, like in a standard tomographic approach. It's irregular. This depends on how the microscope, in this case, the tweezers, can be controlled and how they can be moved around. We will see afterwards that in principle, it has a possibility to record more data than you need, but in many cases, we get actually too little information about with the rotations which we are performing. So what I will talk now, it will become a little bit more mathematical. So the forward model, when you record these images, you can make several assumptions. The images which we have seen before are typically considered, or very often considered, optical projection images. But if you want to make it more precise, you can also assume diffraction scattering, which changes the model which you're using. So this is then that we have an object which has low contrast, relatively low contrast, and we also observe the scattering in a more sophisticated model. So what is the inverse problem? We have depending on the measurement data and the model which we are using, the simplest case, if you use optical projection imaging, then we reconstruct the attenuation. And if we work with low contrast scattering objects, then we reconstruct the scattering potential. So what we make in the whole topic as an assumption is that when the object is moved, it's a rigid body motion. So local deformation, which are enforced by the tweezers on the object, are not taken into account. So it's really just a rigid motion which the object is exposed to, which simplifies, of course, the considerations. Another simplification comes into the game that when we do diffraction then when we consider a scattering model, then we assume interferometric measurements. This means that we can record intensity and phase of the object. If one doesn't do this interferometric measurements, then one uses these more sophisticated scattering models, then one has to do also reconstruct the phase, do a phase retrieval, which everyone knows is quite delicate. So here we still assume that we have interferometric measurements, that we have intensity and phase measurements. So the essential thing what we do in this tomographic reconstruction is try to reconstruct the irregular motions. So the tweezers enforce some motions, and we assume that they are more or less irregular. So not like in standard tomography where you are put in this this scanner, and this is a cylindrical movement and you can record slice by slice. So here this is not possible anymore. So you have to reconstruct the full 3D reconstruction. Not slice by slice, but fully 3D. Okay, so now there comes the outline, and you will see immediately a gap which I'm presenting. So first of all, I will do the motion detection based on optical projection imaging data. Then I will do a tomographic inversion based on a diffraction scattering model. But what is missing so far is a motion detection based on a diffraction model. We have formulated this problem, but we have no solution at the moment for these kinds of problems. So it will really be two parts, which I consider in my talk. The first one is this motion detection based on more or less in resulting afterwards an inversion of the X-ray transform. And then we make some tomographic inversion, but without motion detection for a scattering model. So there's some gap which we want to pursue in the next few months. Okay, so now this comes to this motion detections of particles, and here we assume optical projection data. So let us first make a little bit of notation which we have to use afterwards. So first of all, we define the center of the object with this formula. So it's more or less the center of mass, but it's of course not really mass which we are considering in physical terms, but it's just the center of an object. But you can also identify it if it's more convenient for you as the center of mass. So here we take the first moment and we divide it by the zeroth moment, and this gives us the center of mass. So what we assume is then that the object, which is always denoted by U in this case, is exposed to a rigid motion around its center. So rigid motion means we have a translation, but the translation is always considered relative to the center of mass, to the C3. And then it's rotated. So we have this rigid motion, and we describe it in particular with respect to the center of mass. And then the illumination, which we consider, is always in E3 direction. The minus doesn't matter, because if you illuminate from the opposite direction, it will always be the same. So here you have this object, this ring, and here this rotations visualized. Okay, so then what we record is the projection mapping, or the X-ray transform, or Radon transform. I think the more precise statement, it's the X-ray transform. So you illuminate in this case, it means that the light travels along a line, and it's not banded through the object. So that we have here this object description. Then we have here this rigid body motion, this A of RT. And then we record the projection image, which is just the X-ray transform of this rotated object. So in particular, what we are interested in is just these two parameters, the translation and the rotation, what we want to identify. And of course, one simple way to do it would be a least squares approach, but this gets rather complicated because in this case, we always have to make a grid structure for every translation and rotation. And so an algorithm based on least squares seems to be rather time relevant. So we try to figure out these translations and rotations without going to a least squares approach in the beginning. Okay, so this is now the fundamental Fourier theorem, which will come several times in my talk. So actually at the left hand side, what you see here, this JTR are more or less the measurements. So this is the projection images which you are recording with this tomographic approach for given T and R. And if you take the Fourier the two-dimensional Fourier transform with respect to the k variable, with respect to the x2 and x1 and x2 variables, then you get the variable k. This is more or less on the left-hand side is the measurement data. And on the right-hand side, you see more or less the function u. If R and the rotation is and the translation is given. So this is the fundamental. Well, you observe it in many applications, also in the radon transform itself, so that you reduce the radon transform to a decomposition of an inverse of the two-dimensional radon transform, the two-dimensional Fourier transform applied to a three-dimensional Fourier transform. So this is the essential thing. Here is the projection coming up and a joint projection, which is maps onto the third component because this is the third component where we are illuminating. So, but the essential thing of the bottom line is this, if you have the measurement data and from these, if you apply the Fourier transforms, you more or less can see the Fourier transform of the data which you want to reconstruct. Okay, so this is what we are utilizing, and it looks complicated, but forget about these exponential terms, they are not so essential. That the real essential thing is here is measurement data, and on the right hand side, just in here, you see the function u which you want to reconstruct. And if you would know the rotations, you would immediately get from the measurement data the function u. But of course, we don't know them, so it's a little bit more complicated. Okay, so now let's do it in a few steps. First of all, determine the translation. This is relatively easy. Then we clear the attenuation map to a reduced attenuation mapping where we get rid of the translation. And then we only reconstruct the rotation. And then I also use the common line property, which is a term which comes from cryo-EM imaging, to determine the rotation. And just as a constraint, this should not be a fourth item, it just should be a command. In cryo-EM, the rotation is considered arbitrary, so we don't have this continuous movement of the object. This is different. There, it's really discrete rotations which have to be identified. But other than that, actually, you can use the same techniques or the same algorithms which are used in cryo-EM to detect the rotations. But of course, here there's a little bit more information because we know that there is a smooth transition between the images going on. Okay, so now let's come to determine the translation. This is relatively easy, because if you look at attenuation mapping and look at the moment, then you can determine again by scaling by the zeroth moment the center of mass of the projection images. So this is the same, this is completely analogous how we determined the three-dimensional center of mass of the whole images, or how we defined the 3D center of mass of the whole object which we want to reconstruct. Here we do it just for the projection images. And what you see is, if you project into X3 translation scaled by this center of mass of the whole image, then you see the two-dimensional projection or center of mass. So this allows you now to reconstruct immediately the two components by just of the projection of the translation. The third component you cannot reconstruct, because if you look at in the image in the X3 direction, you will not observe a difference. I mean, it's just if you shift it in towards the image to the object towards the observer in the direction of the imaging plane, you will not see a difference. Of course, in practice there might be shading effects, but if it's based on the X-ray transform, you don't see a difference if you move it towards the observer. So anyway, but from this center of mass, you can already infer, knowing of course where the C3 is, you can immediately reconstruct the translation. So that was easy. So we know the translation, and now we come to try to identify the rotation. And here we make this reduced attenuation map. So actually what we do is, now we have these projection images, then we apply a two-dimensional Fourier transform in the measurement plane. Then we get this function here, and then we scale it by this exponential term. And what this gives us, so just to recall, this is the attenuation mapping. This is what we really measure, projection into X3 direction. And what happens now is that this function which comes up here, more or less you make a Fourier transform where you introduce ones e to the minus I and some terms, you compensate it by this factor. And if you do this, this gets independent of the translation. So actually what comes out here is not the function which depends on this translation anymore, but it's just the function of the rotation. And so this is now the function which we will use to determine this rotation. This is not, unfortunately, not that easy anymore. But there is some tensor calculus which you have to use. Don't worry too much. It's at the end, you can look up these formulas. I give you the reference afterwards. But essentially what one does is that one, instead of reconstructing the rotation, one reconstruct the angular velocity given here by this omega. And this we decompose into two functions. This alpha is the intensity of the rotation in the imaging plane, and a third component, omega 3, which is again relatively easy to reconstruct. And then in the second step, we reconstruct this V. And once we have this V, we reconstruct this alpha. And this shows more or less the increase of the complexity of the problem. So it, at the end, when we reduce it, we get this function with W3 already from this implicit equation. So the first thing, and this is where we use that the data is moved continuously. If we measure this data, this attenuated or if we plot this attenuated data and differentiate it in time, and then we can divide it by this evaluation. So it's more or less the first derivative of this attenuation function. Then we see that this is independent of mu, and this we can use more or less. We don't have a proof that we can reconstruct this explicitly and uniquely. I mean, there are obvious non-uniqueness with this omega-3, but essentially you can reconstruct this omega-3 in practice from this formula. So just taking into account that it's invariant with this mu gives you typically a quite unique solution of the third component of the angular velocity. So what you see here, these are first derivatives of the measurement data which you have, but you have to evaluate them at particular points. So let's assume we have now this W, then we also know by this implicit equation the V. This is this has to be algorithmically implemented, but there is no proof so far that this is unique, aside from some obvious non-uniqueness issues. But let's assume we can do this, then the question remains on how to reconstruct this alpha. And this gets a very nasty formula, but it's essentially an ODE which you have to solve. But I guess the bottom line of this whole formula, it looks nasty, but what you really see is that the measurement data which you have here need to be three times differentiated. So here, always when a three pops up, needs at least three times differentiation of the data. Here, also three times time derivative and two times differentiation of the data. So it's not a trivial problem to solve this equation. Even if this is just an ODE to solve, we still need to differentiate the data twice, which is quite a nasty business, actually. And this shows that this problem is really quite unstable to solve and quite tricky to solve. But in principle, this was a way, without solving the least squares problems, to just reconstruct the rotation and the translation. Okay, so just about the first part of my talk, the motion can be reconstructed based on Fourier techniques. After this 3D image can be reconstructed with back projection formula for the X-ray transform. We have also done it with some software which is used for cryo-EM, where I said before that the rotations are completely arbitrary, and to find the common lines or the angles between the rotations with the software Aspire. There are some issues with this one as well as the three-dimensional differentiation. So we can recall either the differentiation of data, or we can do it with Aspire. Some of them gives comparable results. This is actually in the application our biggest problem, that we more or less we need to differentiate the data three times, and the data is quite noisy. So this is a real issue to get out these reconstructions. Now, let us do something different. As I said, I will move now to a scheduling model, making the model more accurately. But now I assume that the motion is known. So what I would do as a prerequisite step, actually, before for projection images, I assume now that this is known for a scattering model. So this is a gap in these techniques which we are using. And I hope we can close it. It will not be that easy as it sounds, but it's really much more delicate and more interesting approach to do it for a scattering model than just for the projection images. Okay, so here is what we assume. We assume a scattering model. So this is Helmholtz equation. We assume it in free space, so in R2. Not all the time, but this is the most convenient thing. And we assume we illuminate the object with an incident light. This I call always U-inc, so the incident field. It should satisfy the homogeneous wave equation with constant background, so with k not zero. So what we really need from this incident field is that it solves the homogeneous wave equation. But the material is inhomogeneous, so I assume, I hope I don't confuse too much with the notation, but this k is now the material parameter and not frequency space as it was before. But this is now the thing which I'm really interested in. So I put this in as a material parameter in the Helmholtz equation, and then I have total field, which consists of the incident field and the scattered field as usual, and this solves this Helmholtz equation. It's the Helmholtz equation in with respect to intensity and phase. So I consider it in a complex with complex values. So everything what I do here, U, is now always a complex field or a complex vector, which was not the case in the tomography setting. There, everything was just an intensity image. Okay, Born and Rütthoff approximation, the first step which we approach, it makes life much simpler. And of course, it also results in some in many cases which are relevant for this optical imaging, actually in quite relevant approximations. So what one does in the Born approximation is I guess folklore. You write down the equation for the scattered field. The total field consists of the incident field plus the scattered field. Plug this into the Helmholtz equation, then you get two terms. In the first term, the k not zero is constant, and then you get two terms which add up to the equation on the previous side. So if you look back, you just plug in u incident plus u scattered field, and you write this as an update of k not zero plus f. And then you get in total these six terms. And when you sum them up, you get exactly these four terms. And this is a quadratic term because this is assumed to be small relative to k0. And this scattered field is assumed to be small relative to u, the incident field, so you ignore it. And this gives you the Born approximation. Rütthoff approximation takes the logarithm of the function u in some natural complex some branches. You do this for u dot, you do this for u inc, and then you get the equation for the Rütthoff approximation, in this case for the phase. And from this you can also go back to the u. So essentially this is the Rütthoff approximation. You take a logarithm of the Born approximation, and then you get the phase of the which you use, which typically is considered the Rütthoff approximation. So also the formulas are formally equivalent. They differ in the way they are practically used. There's always the thing how you get to the Born and Rütthoff approximations. So actually this is after making the phase, plugging in the field again for the phase. Instead of the phase, you get this formula, which is written now algorithmically. And the way we use it now is we get measurement data of the Rütthoff, we get measurement data of something of u, which is definitely not the root of approximation or not the Born approximation. We assume afterwards it comes as the solution of Helmholtz equation. So if this is our measurement data, the question is now how you use this measurement data. You can use it here, then you get the Born approximation data, or you can use the Born approximation directly. So the question, what you record is then encoded into the kind of approximation. So if you assume you measure root of, you plug in your measurement data here and you get some Born approximation. And afterwards we work with the Born approximation. If we assume Born as the standard, then we just measure the left-hand side. So this is just at the end, we work with the Born approximation, I invert the Born approximation. But the way how we differently need Born and Rüthoff is just via the measurement data. Okay, so now we come to this question of how to reconstruct the function f. Note f is the update of k squared minus k naught zero squared. And we assume that we have some measurements of the scattered data, and we assume that we just use it in the Born approximation so that we have a weakly scattering medium. What is now particular for these trapping experiments is that the rotation is irregular. And what's particular about this microscopic experiment, which we assume, is that the incident wave and the measurement plane are aligned. So we go with the incident wave goes straight, let's say, to the imaging plane, and the imaging plane corresponds with the measurement plane. Okay, so this is now our object. Simplified, so we have an object with a compact support, and here we have the incident wave. It comes like this, and then it's recorded in this imaging plane at x3. So this is particular for this kind of problems. The incident and the measurement plane are aligned. Here, this is a transmission experiment. This is a reflection experiment. So the incident wave comes in here, and then it's measured here. So now there comes some geometrical problems. So we have we go to this K space, which is the, at the end we take, as in all these formulas, we take the two-dimensional Fourier transform of the measurement data. So we get from x1 and x2, we get k1 and k2. And this is the there's certainly a name which I forgot now, but this term k naught zero squared minus k1 squared minus k2 squared. So in k space, we look to the difference of the background medium material properties. And we define it as this real number, if this is satisfied, and if this is complex, then we define it just with the imaginary part. So this is our formula, again, that which relates the UN. So this is our measurement data again, with the thing which we want to reconstruct, completely analogous to the first part, actually. Now this is the update, which I called F, and not the real absorption as it was in the previous part. But otherwise, it's really the same. What changes now is this sign. So if we have a reflection image, it comes with minus. If it comes a transmission experiment, it comes with plus. So that's the only thing how the measurement change here. Again, this plus and minus, maybe I should have marked it with red as well. But one is the transmission and the other one is the reflection, the recorded reflection data. Okay, so there comes something which fascinated me for some time. So for instance, if this K gets imaginary, then we cannot use standard Fourier transform. We have to go to the complex Fourier transform. And in this case, actually, we get some different measurement data. It's somehow, maybe one could call it, these are the evanescent waves which are recorded. But in principle, this is what physics always tries to avoid, to use this, not always, but mostly try to avoid this kind of measurements because they are damped. So at the end, I will ask the question, what happens if we avoid these highly damped waves? So every rotation angle determines then a 2D manifold in this K-space. K-space just means we take the Fourier transform in the spatial variables. And at the end, what I would like to show is that from these Fourier formulas, you get some very efficient reconstruction formulas based on the non-uniform FFT. Okay, so this is now the geometry which comes out when you ignore the damped waves. So this is just the ones where this kappa, maybe I can recall it, this function kappa, where it becomes real. So in R3, this gets these golden fingers, this golden, no, it's not fingers, but potato shaped form, or donut. And if you just take some projection images, this is a 3D transmission image, then you get these figures. So these are in K space or frequency space, these are the kinds of frequencies you can reconstruct. If you do reflection image, then you get just this moon-like shaped coverage of the K space. Transmission gives you this information. So the difference is if you do transmission image, then you get low frequency data. If you get these reflection images, if you do reflection experiments, then you just get high frequency data. This is of course something which is known in the literature. It's known in the ultrasound literature by, for instance, in Natterer's book already. A little bit different is the setup because in microscopy you have a very particular alignment between incident waves and, well, you can do it differently, but this is the one which we considered. And in the seismic literature, there are similar observations made by Mora, for instance, already in long time ago, 40 years ago maybe. Okay. But of course, if you have some possibilities like moving not just around this E1 axis, but also in the E2 axis, then you get more coverage in low frequency in transmission images and high frequency images. So you just not just rotate the object in around one axis, but if you rotate it about two axes, then you get a more complete coverage of the frequency range. But the picture stays the same. Transmission gives you low frequency data and reflection gives you high frequency data. So this is now a field which gives you then back projection formulas. But they are just based on not exact formulas, but they are based on just using the not highly damped waves. So the ones which gives you real number of these kappas in this A. So the integral here essentially is about this A, which is this golden shaped figure. And I don't want to go into details. What you do is afterwards to get some reconstruction formulas is you parametrize the curves, how you rotate the image. Note that in this part of this talk, I assume that the rotation is given. So I know the parameterization of the translation and the rotations. Translations, I don't care here, but just the rotations. And then I have to look for the reconstruction based on knowing these projection images with these kind of rotations. And the way is actually simple. It's just I look for a parametrization of this golden figure, which you have seen on the left-hand side, which is filled by this function u, which is parameterized by this function u. And then I have to make sure and know how often a point in this A is met by elements of U. So it's just a transformation formula, change of variables formula. This then is done with this determinant. So essentially this tells you how often points are made in this parametrization. And if you then write it out, it's some tedious calculations, but if you parameterize, then you get this curve. And interestingly, if the axis of rotation is kept constant, then it reduces to a very simple formula, which gives you essentially some established reconstruction formulas. So in general, this is quite complicated, or not complicated, tedious to calculate, but if you have some particular knowledge about the rotation, in this case, a simple rotation axis, then you can simplify this formula. Finally, I show you just pictures. So this is now how the waves look like. This is some forward numerics. Here we have worked with a line source. An object which is a scattering object which is here. This is the wave, the total field which comes in for a line source. This is the scattered field from the line source. So you remove the incident field from this from this field, then you see this one. And this is actually the data from the measurement data of this one is actually then how we do the reconstruction. For the point sources, it looks very similar, but the objects are a little bit different. But the scattered field, again, looks very similar to the line segment. So because we are far away from the object itself. Okay. Then we do some approximation based on Ritthoff approximation. This is, as you have seen, a transmission experiment, so there's everything is positive. This is just the recall of the formula, but we only use this function where this is real. And here, after rescaling, but here you see some things with some reconstructions with Born approximations. Essentially, if the k is increasing, then you get it's not quite surprising, but you get a better resolution of the image. If you increase, but the best reconstructions, and this is not quite so easy to understand, is if you consider the reconstruction with several frequencies. I think the highest frequency should essentially do it, but in principle, the lower frequencies give you some stabilization. On the other hand, there is an interesting effect in these images, in the numerical images, which I don't know why it comes, but but you always see in the middle a point popping up, and this is a complete artifact which we don't know really why it comes in. But it's in Born and Ritthoff approximation, we always see this artifact. So I don't know why it really happens, but it's there. Full waveform inversion doesn't show this art. It shows this artifact also slightly, but not as significantly as before. So full waveform inversion is really the inverse problems for the Helmholtz equation. So it's not the linearized problem, but it's the full nonlinear problem. Here, the reconstructions are in general much better. And this, of course, increases if the contrast in the object is increasing, or the size of the object is increasing as well. But in many cases, it pays off to use the full waveform inversion. And some of the artifacts are gone, which I think is a nice, is really a nice feature of the full waveform inversion. Okay, so conclusion of the second part. So what we did is we assumed that the motion estimation has been done, but then we did a scattering an inversion for the scattering model. So the most challenge is I guess now to extract the motion with different techniques first, and then to base on this top on top of this a tomographic inversion. This is our challenge and future working plan. And with this, I thank you very much for your attention.
Great, Ottmar, thanks for a very nice talk. The floor is open for questions, so please unmute yourself if you have questions for Ottmar. So I was wondering, so you sort of, you consider both the Ritto and the Born approximation sort of, but they can be related. So it wasn't clear to me, what is the advantage of viewing it in terms of the one or the other?
So actually it took me along, and I obviously didn't communicate it very well to understand, because they are more or less equivalent. So you can calculate from the Ritter approximation, the Born approximation. So the way how we used it is we get measurement data in many cases from simulations, and then the only issue is you say the measurement data I consider as Ritter approximation, or I consider them as Born approximation. That's the only thing what we are doing. So for this measurement, we just measure on one plane. There we measure this U, and then we say, well, it's a Ritter approximation, or we say it's a Born approximation. That's the only thing what we are doing. And then we use this formula with the unwrapping. If we say it's a Ritter approximation, we use the unwrapping. We get data for the Born approximation, so one further step. And this data we use then in the inversion for the with this Fourier theorem. So this one additional step is comes on top of Ritter approximation, and surprisingly, in every case, this is better than the Born approximation, and it allows you to reconstruct higher contrast. I could show you some results, but in the paper where you see a lot of ring artifacts, which you avoid with Ritter approximation. But it somehow was, I mean, it's probably known, but it was not clear for me how you really use this Ritter approximation with practical experiments.
Yes. So any other questions for Ottmar? So I was a little bit curious. So for this motion rotation estimation, you need actually a third derivative. So you somehow, it was a little bit surprising that you actually need the third derivative. What's the intuition behind, do you have an intuition for it? And do you have to do some regularization when you actually compute this?
Oh yeah. So why it's particular the third?
I
have no real intuition why this comes to the third. I mean that the most I observed several times that three pops up if you use some inversion for the wave equations. This happened to me two times, actually three times now. So there must be more behind this, but I could not give you a very good feeling about why this happens. It maybe has to do with the second order of the differential equation and one where you have the dynamics. This is what I expected that this happens. So one, and this you see also in the formulas, one is the dynamics and the second one is the differentiation of the data. So this might be the reason why third comes into the game. But on the other hand, you have third derivatives in the K variable as well. So it's not completely consistent. But the other question is we need a lot of regularization and definitely this also makes some resolution. So we cannot resolve very accurately the rotations. So because we need such a lot of regularization to be able to deal with the third derivatives. In physics, probably on the experimental side, what physics people are also doing in the experiments, they put some trackers onto the object, and then just follow the trackers, which this could be virtual things, which high curvature points or some real points which are illuminating. This will probably be the way to go. In practice, I think this third derivative is really a handicap for reconstructing the motion.
Great. So any other questions for Otmar? Otherwise, thanks again so much for a very, very nice talk. It's very clear. So thanks for your talk, Otmar.
Thanks, Knut, for inviting me. It was a pleasure to be part of this meeting.
Yeah. Well, next time I hope you can come in person. So hopefully you're moving towards a space where actually physical traveling is possible.